Good day to you one and all. It is I, Justin Hawkins, and this is Justin Hawkins Rides Again. Today I'm talking about a band that is named after the year I was born, 1975. What a brilliant year for music. And obviously the band's probably not named after that year because it's the year that I was born. Are they? I don't know why they're called that. This is one of those bands where a few people have said, oh, you should listen to this band, the 1975. And I just never bothered with it, really. I heard a couple of things that one of my friends really does like them a lot. Showed me a couple of songs. I was like, yeah, it's all right. But it never caught fire in my heart. Do you know what I mean by that? But they've got a new song out, which apparently is not indicative of their wider oeuvre. And I will get some remarks along the lines of, yeah, you should listen to more of this stuff. It's not all like that. Which I perfectly understand, but this happens to be the latest release, and so that's the one I'm going to talk about. The song is called Part of the Band, released on July the 7th, and the album is called Being Funny in a Foreign Language, and it's their fifth album. Justin Hawkins rides again. Horrible, unemphatic striking of that chord there. Might need to change these strings at some point, but, you know, I won't burden you with that information. Their second album, I Like It When You Sleep, For You Are So Beautiful, Yet So Unaware of It, in 2016, reached number one in the US, UK, Canada, Australia, and New Zealand. So this is a big band. Why aren't I more aware of their music? According to Vice, they have been the most hated and loved band in the world and described as underrated and overhyped, although the needle has far more often swung towards the former direction, meaning underrated. Veteran rock critic Robert Christgau said he thinks they suck and they should not be called a rock band as they do not rock. He probably didn't say it in that voice, but perhaps he should have. Another critic has said that their music is pop in the realm of alternative, most comparable to NXS. Who doesn't love NXS? I mean, but the thing about NXS is, it's Mickey Hutchins, isn't it? It's all that charisma, that sensuality, that hair, that nose, that face, that body, the voice. It's all that stuff. It's the complete package. It's a unique sort of innate charisma that not everybody has. So let's look upon the video and decide once and for all, what the fuss is all about. Oh, it's a windy, misty moor. Stay on the path, lads. Stay on the path. That's from an American Werewolf in London, but just not very well remembered or observed or indeed delivered. Just rubbish. Sounds like when you start up a PlayStation and then it sort of has that the sound of an orchestra tuning. PlayStation 2. She was part of the Air Force, I was part of the band. I always used to burst into my hand. My imagination. It's a really interesting arrangement. It seems to be like violins, violas. There's some. Just as I paused it there, they seem poised to bring the violins in, which they evidently do. But there's also something electronic in their hands. There's a sort of. Like a. I mean, it might be a cello, but I don't think it is. I was living my best life, living my parents' way before the pain penance and verbal propellants. And my. It's really hard to get a read on what the key of it is. And I fell in love with a boy. Kinda lame, I was Rambo. Fell in love with my. It just sounds like the song itself is. I mean, it's hard to sort of separate what's happening in the song from the arrangement, but it's like without all that string quartet madness, it's much simpler when it lets on. Hang on. Capo on two. No.
with a boy, it was kinda lame. I was Rambo and he was Paul Verlaine.
I was living my best life. You know, you could actually just imagine it as a, I don't know, something like an old Bruce Springsteen or a Tom Petty song, something like that. But the way they've actually, the instrumentation that they've chosen makes it really sort of, it disguises what is just basically a simple song, you know. For me, it's an interesting, it's really interesting actually, because it's like normally you would endeavour to simplify things and just make it more palatable to the ear, you know, just a guy going, I was living my best life. You know, that's all you want to hear really, isn't it? But maybe it's not. And I always feel like it's going to kick off and then be the band thing to show you what it really is, you know, like all of this, the strings and the sort of the weird thing that's pulsing. And then, so that one that pulses goes up to here occasionally, which is a D sharp over what I think is probably an E. You know, and the rest of the guys aren't acknowledging that. And the rest of the guys, by when I say the guys, I mean the cellist and the violinist. But whoever's doing the sort of synth part is finding this. It makes your ears prick up, and it sort of pulls you around and makes you go, oh, hang on, what is this? What even is this thing? But there's a really beautiful and simple lyric over the top of it.
Love with a boy, it was kind of lame.
Fell in love with a boy, it was kind of lame. I love that. And I fell in love with a boy, it was kind of lame. It's just lovely.
So many cringes and heroin binges. I was coming off the hinges, living on the fringes.
Heroin binges, I was coming off the hinges. This is amazing lyric. Living on the fringes. What great. It's not a triplet. A triplet, even. This guy's a serious lyricist.
Coming off the hinges, living on the fringes.
Oh my God, this is a brilliant line. So many cringes and heroin binges coming off the hinges, living on the fringes of my imagination. Fucking brilliant. Oh my God.
On the fringes of my imagination.
Okay, I think I understand what the fuss is all about. This guy is a serious songwriter.
Enough about me now. You gotta talk about the people, baby.
Okay. You can imagine that in the mid-80s being like a huge, I don't know, a wig out with all the electric guitars and all the crash bang wallop of the old band coming in. But they haven't done that. It's still like reduced, and they're really so far they're really sticking to this string quartet thing.
Ooh. I can't get the language right. Tell me what's on my mind.
God, it's gorgeous. Fucking hell, this is really good. Wow. Okay, so we're looking at a mainstream act that actually does interesting stuff. Where have I been? What put me off about this band in the first place, I think, was probably like this, you know, they're definitely accomplished musicians, but I felt like it had a sort of smugness that you, unless you're Duran Duran, you can't get away with, really. But what I'm hearing here is just like, it's real sincerity and just beautiful and reserved and withdrawn, and even the way he's playing the drums, it's like there's no bombast in that. He's really playing for the song, and it's just delicate and it has finesse. It's awesome, actually.
Back chic baristas, Sydney's on a communist keistas, writing about their ejaculations.
Writing about their ejaculations, that's brilliant. Ejaculations used to mean something different in the olden days. Here's a literary reality for you. It just used to mean gush forth, you know. Usually it would be an exclamation or something like that. It came to mean and be associated with the final climactic moments of a sex act, but I think he's being clever and using the old English use of it. I think he's very clever. This is a clever person.
I like my men like I like my coffee, full of soy milk and so sweet it won't offend anybody. While
I like my men like I like my coffee, full of soy milk and so sweet it won't offend anybody. My God.
Worst inside of us,
So it goes to this lovely descending thing from D sharp minor. I think that's C sharp major, and then B, and then F sharp. And then it has this sort of, but I don't play it like that. That's how a rock guitarist plays it. It's more like, I'm in the Stones. It really bears a lot of different interpretations. I mean, this is just the one they've chosen, like a really withdrawn kind of acoustic-y pretty moment, but it could easily be a rocking bit. This is a versatile structure and lyric. I'm pretty blown away by this, actually. Does it show? Oh, I love that. There's a... They do one of those chords where it's like, I think it's like a C sharp, and then the root rises one to a D, and it can only ever be a sort of passing chord, really, can't it? Because it's taking you somewhere. You'd imagine it's going to be, that would make the most sense, wouldn't it? But you could easily, you know, you can go there as well. You can go anywhere, really, but. I always like it when you hear those things, because it's basically that chord is making a promise to the listener, and how it delivers on that is the interesting part, really. And here come the saxophone players. One of them's wearing a beret. I did the right thing. Yes. They're not trying to put headphones over the top of it. That's why theirs is more voluminous than mine. I could have a beret that looks like that. But I choose to wear these oversized headphones, which really restricts it doesn't allow it to billow when I'm on a moor playing a sax solo. All right, fair enough. But I could do that if I wanted to. I've not picked up them 1,400 days and 9 hours and 16 minutes. And now you can hear what's really happening. This is the bit I was hoping for, when it opens up and then that sort of chord sequence that we were hearing earlier. It's more obvious what they're doing. I mean, if you think about that, this isn't the whole chord sequence, but some of it is actually this. I mean, that's rudimentary, actually, isn't it? They've really... found a way to arrange that with absolute tension that makes that lyric pop. It's just, it's a really impressive. I just love this. I'm going to listen to it again and again and again. That's brilliant. And it bears repeating to find all the nuance and actually sort of try and figure out what is saying in a couple of places. And it's going to be worth it. Actually, really impressed by that. And it's just great to hear something that's so popular be so good. Underrated. That's what I think. Because I've overlooked them in the past, and I won't do that again. I have been shocked and startled into admitting that the 1975 is fucking amazing, actually. Justin Hawkins writes again. Don't forget to like, subscribe, hit the bell for notifications, and watch one of these two videos. You might also be surprised by the things that you learn. Or see, at least. Nice one, guys. See you on the ice.